Good afternoon. This is Leanne Breckenridge. I am going to talk to you about the child with cerebral dysfunction. I've tried an audio and for some reason I cannot upload it for you all, so I'm going to try a different route. Hopefully this will work for you all. So you can see our objectives here, and I'm not going to read through those with you because you guys can read. And then the next slide, on slide 3, we're talking about pediatric neurological examination. So what I want you to do is ask yourself what kind of signs and symptoms would a child with a neurological disorder present to you? And stop for a minute and think about that before we get into it, because you probably already know. And we're going to talk more extensively about that. But one thing you're looking at with this baby right here is sunsetting eyes. This is a baby with hydrocephalus, and we're going to get into that a little bit more. So you can see how you can see so much more of the sclera, and you can see that the iris and the pupil are look like they're set like a setting sun. And so that's a classic example of a child with increased intracranial pressure. So let's talk about our levels of consciousness, and you will need to know this for the test. So confusion, that's an impaired decision making. So I know that you probably know what I'm talking about when I talk about confusion, because we're often all confused at some point, and impaired from whatever it may be, too much information in your brain, to a bump on the head, to too much alcohol intake, or whatever makes you confused. Most of the time, I shouldn't say most of the time, many times this can be an indication of a worsening problem, but lots of times it's just from a minor blip in life, and we soon get reoriented and we go on our way. So the next one is disorientation. So we have a decreased level of consciousness, and so you're disoriented to time and place. You often don't know who the President of the United States is, what year you were born. You don't know your family members, etc. Then you have obtunded, and these are individuals that will not respond to you verbally, but they will respond to pain. And if you can remember back, I don't know, in health assessment, if you were taught how to see if somebody responds to pain, but one of the best ways is to take your fist and rub it really hard on their sternum. Lots of time people will try to pinch. Many people will not respond to that, but a sternal rub, they will respond to pain. Then we have stupor, and this is response to vigorous or repeated stimuli. These people act like they're in a very, very, very deep sleep. If you keep at them, they will eventually respond. It won't be like they're going to wake up and start talking to you, but they will blink or they will flinch or something. And then coma, you essentially have no motor or verbal response to any kind of painful stimuli at all. And then persistent vegetative state, this is where you've lost the function of your cerebral cortex. Here's where I like to tell the story about this little boy who came in. He was walking home from school, and he was in a crosswalk and a car hit him. And this has been probably 15 years ago when I took care of this child. Anyway, needless to say, a car hit him. He was comatose for several months. I was taking care of him, and then one day he just woke up and he looked around and he said, "I have been in a bat cave for a very long time." And so that is one of the very remarkable things that we see sometimes with these with head trauma or some of these significant issues that go on with the brain. All of these, of course, are something that we need to be concerned about. Level of consciousness is one of our first indicators that something is not going right. So, we look at the purpose, or why do we look at altered consciousness? First thing we need to do is know what a baseline is for this child. So, how are we going to find that out? You've never seen this kid before. They come into the emergency room. How are you going to find out what their baseline is? Well, one thing you can do is ask lots of questions to the family. Is this child's normal? Some children live with chronic altered neurological function. So if you have cerebral palsy or you have some other neurological dysfunction, this may not be a change for them at all. But then a child that's typical, that's been out riding his bike and playing and running and going to school, and suddenly they're bumping into the wall, or they can't remember what their name is or when their birthday is, that can be a huge change. And so you need to have a very in tune family member with them so that you can know if this is a change from baseline. So the other thing we're going to look at is vital signs. Temperature, very, very important. Do they have a fever? Oftentimes with a fever, they can get a little bit confused. They kind of act dazed in a sense. The other thing you have to think about with a high fever is seizures, a febrile seizure. You also look at drug ingestion. Did they get a hold of somebody's medication? Then you also look at like a hypothalamic indication. Was there some kind of hypothalamic damage of some type? Or hypothermia, for example. You've heard of those children that have been submerged in water for a very, very long time, or they've been out in the freezing cold, and then they go into a toxic coma. The other thing we have to look at is pulse. Your pulse is going to be variable. And so your pulse is going to probably be normal at first, then it's going to rise, and then it will bottom out. And you also need to know that your blood pressure is going to be the very last sign to change. So if your blood pressure starts to not be consistent, you have your baseline, and if your blood pressure begins to rise and then bottom out, you better be acting quickly, especially in a child with meningitis. That can indicate oftentimes that they are septic. And then respiratory rate, if they are having some kind of neurological dysfunction, they're going to have slow, deep respirations. Many times with sedatives, they'll have those slow, deep respirations. And then, of course, after a seizure or any kind of cerebral infection, such as meningitis. You also want to look at the rate and the rhythm of their breathing. Now, remember that babies breathe a little bit differently. And babies do have periods of apnea, but older children do not. And so, if you see an older child who is having some apnea, this can be an ominous sign, and you guys need to be acting quickly. So, then we're also going to look at skin. Do you see any petechiae? We're going to talk about meningococcemia in a little bit, and these children will break out in petechiae all over their body. I think I remember mentioning this to you when we talked about vaccines and why it's so important to get the meningococcal vaccine. And children with meningococcemia can die within hours of being infected. You have to look for an injury. Is if the child comes in with a head injury, do you see a big bump on their head? Or is there some kind of bite, or like an insect bite or a tick bite or something like that? Very, very important to examine the skin. Then we're going to look at the eyes. Pupils, are they pinpoint? Sometimes pinpoint pupils can indicate that there's been some kind of poisoning. I remember taking care of a child, and he and his little friend were playing in a fertilizer plant, and both boys ended up dying because they ended up getting poisoned from that fertilizer plant. Are their pupils widely dilated and still reactive? Sometimes after a seizure, this will happen. And then you also have to look and see, are the pupils equal and reactive, or is one bigger than the other? In other words, unilateral. Or are the pupils widely dilated and fixed? And usually this is not a good sign at all. That usually means there's a paralysis of the cranial nerve number three. That can be a herniation of the brain. And lots of times children with brain tumors will get to this point. Are their pupils fixed bilaterally more than five minutes? And this can indicate brainstem damage. You've always heard, oh, their pupils are fixed and dilated, and usually there's no returning back to this world once that happens. Is there a sudden fixed and dilation of the pupils? And as you can imagine, this is an emergency. The other thing is a doll's head maneuver. And what a doll head maneuver is you move the head to one side and going opposite, in other words, if the eyes move opposite of the direction the head is going, that's normal. What a doll's head maneuver does is stays right there with you. So when we're talking about doll's head maneuver, one more time, I just want to make sure that you all are clear that if the eyes are fixed and they're not moving from side to side, that could be a problem. So then the next thing we're going to talk about is caloric or ovulo-vestibular movement. What you can do is you can get ice water, you put it in an ear, and the eyes should move to the opposite side, away from the cold. And if it does not, that can indicate neurological damage. So, talking about motor responses to altered consciousness, we want to make sure that we're observing spontaneous movement and also response to pain, which we already talked about. You want to look to see if there's any kind of tremors, twitching, any kind of muscle spasms, any kind of that it's kind of a fight or flight type response, or a refusal to do something, or a resistance. So if you are pulling on somebody's arm and they're having this negative response to you, they're going to pull or resist you. Kind of like if you think about somebody with very tight arm muscles with cerebral palsy, if you pull against them, oftentimes it'll cause a tremor and they'll even get tighter. Whereas if they're just lying there quietly, it's not a real tight arm. I hope that makes sense. Then talking about the posturing, and I hope that you all remember this from health assessment. Anytime you are flexing or you're decorticate, you're flexing in toward the cord. That's how I remember it. If you are facing out away from the cord, that's decebrate. So decorticate means typically that there's dysfunction to the cerebral cortex or the brainstem. Oftentimes there's a brain tumor involved. If it's decebrate, away from the cord, it can mean that there's a problem with the midbrain. Or brainstem, or oftentimes a stroke. I'm sure you can think of examples of people that you've seen with both of these. Let's talk about reflexes real quick. You guys have probably already been taught reflexes in OB with the normal newborn. First of all, let's talk about the corneal reflex. People with altered consciousness will have an absent corneal reflex. You and I, those of us that are neurologically intact, anytime somebody takes a cotton ball and swipes our eye, we'll blink to keep it away out of our eye. Somebody that has a neurological defect will not have that reflex. Then also the presence of the tonic neck. And what the tonic neck is, it's also associated with severe brain damage. What tonic neck is, you turn their head to one side and the leg should stretch out on the side that the head is turned. Now, that is not a normal thing for an older person or an older child. It is very normal for a newborn. but they should grow out of this by the time they're at least age one, and probably sooner than that. So a positive tonic neck reflex or an absent corneal reflex means that there is some kind of severe brain damage. Then looking at neurohealth in young infants, the presence of the neuro, that is normal. That's where you pull them up by their arms and gently let go, and they kind of make a C or kind of a startle with their arms. Tonic neck, like I just told you, you turn their head to one side and their arm and their leg will stretch out. That is normal in a newborn. And then withdrawal reflexes are normal in a healthy newborn. The Babinski, that's where you take your thumb and you can see the picture of that there. You kind of start at the top of the toes and you work your way down, or you can start at the bottom and work your way up, and you'll see the big toe fan, or the big toe will pull up toward the body and the rest of the toes will fan out. And once the children start walking, that reflex goes away. So if you have a child that's 3 or 4 and they have a positive Babinski sign, that is not a good thing. So let's think about increased ICP or intracranial pressure. Typically the cranium is made up of 80% of the brain, 10% of cerebral spinal fluid, and 10% of blood. So the change in one of those things can cause problems. And so you change one and you're gonna compensate in some other fashion. And what happens is typically there's an increase in the intracranial pressure. That can be a tumor, it can be any kind of lesion or space, taking space, or any kind of accumulation of fluid or blood, any kind of blood swelling. Etc. So what is normal ICP? Normal ICP is 0 to 15, and you all should know that for your test. And so what kind of tests can be done to determine whether or not somebody has increased ICP? I just mentioned some of them on the previous slide. The other things you're going to look for increased intracranial pressure are bulging fontanelles. A child will have an increased head circumference, so we've got to know baseline for head circumference on these kids. They will also have a very high-pitched cry. Sometimes you'll hear them say it sounds like a cat crying. They will be extremely irritable, not consoled by their parents at all. Many times they'll be bradycardic, and then they'll also have respiratory changes. Older children, you're going to see irritability. Oftentimes they'll complain of a headache, nausea, and vomiting. They will get bradycardic as well, and they will also have respiratory changes. So to keep the ICP from going up, there are several things that we can do just as nurses. We can keep the child from coughing or straining. We can also avoid bright lights and lots of stimulation. We want to keep them in a dark, quiet room. And also positioning. You don't want to sit them straight up and down, and you don't want to lay them flat on their back. So you want them probably about a 30-degree angle. So I already mentioned these on the previous slide, but let's go over them again. Early on with increased ICP, you're going to have headache. They're going to complain of headaches, many times blurred vision or diplopia, oftentimes nausea and vomiting. They may feel dizzy. They also may have a seizure. If it's an infant, you might have wide suture lines or widened suture lines. Now, when a newborn comes out, many times you can feel a widened suture line simply because their head has had to mold to get in through the vaginal canal. But if it's an older infant, say 3 months old, those suture lines should not be wide anymore. They may also have tense or bulging fontanelles. Like I also explained to you before, they can have a high-pitched cry or the sun-setting eyes. If it is late and their ICP is so high, you're going to see the child become bradycardic. Their level of consciousness is going to decrease. You're going to have a decrease in motor response. They are not going to respond to pain. And then you'll have the Cushing reflex. And what that means is you have a slow pulse with an increased blood pressure. Now, you'll see that more in adults than you will children, but it can happen. Remember that you're taking care of children all the way up to age 18, and typically those kids are considered adults. So let's quickly talk about cerebral trauma and what can cause cerebral trauma. I have a picture here of a young lady that's hitting her head with a soccer ball. This has become more and more of a concern. And they are now asking people whose children play sports to sign a consent allowing them to do so, and also educating them on head injuries involved in different sports. So head injury can involve just the scalp, it can involve the skull, it can involve the meninges, or any kind of brain pathology can involve the brain, and oftentimes it's due to mechanical force from the injury. So some of the causes for those: falls, motor vehicle accidents, bicycle injuries, and I'm sure that you can think of others. So the pathology to this is related to the force of impact. So if you're hit on the back of the head, you need to think, where am I going to see the most trauma? If I'm hit on the side of the head, where am I going to see the trauma or the bleed, etc. Remember too that head size plus insufficient musculoskeletal support, like the little bitty guys, remember they have a humongous head compared to their body, so they're going to be more vulnerable to having head injuries. And so we need to think about those little toddlers that are trying to walk around with this big old head on top of their body and their little bitty feet trying to keep them upright. That's why they fall so much. Very, very important to do some education with families. And so ask yourself, what can I teach? You want to make sure that their house is safe so that they don't hit their head on the side of a coffee table, etc. So what other things can you think about educating? One thing I can think of right off the bat is shaken baby syndrome. These babies come in, we look into their retina, and we can tell that they've been shaken. In other words, somebody picks them up because they're so frustrated with them, and they shake them so hard that their retina detach. And many times these children will also have significant brain damage. The other thing is wearing helmets. Very, very important to wear bicycle helmets. It can keep head injuries from happening so much. So very, very important. Also wearing seat belts so that you don't go flying through a car if your parents have to slam on the brakes. So one thing to think about cerebral edema: once your head is hit, you can have edema happening for the next 24 to 72 hours. And so it's 24 to 72 hours after the trauma. It's just not right away. So you have to be thinking about that, and you need to be educating the parents on if you see a change in their level of consciousness, if they start vomiting, if they are complaining of nausea or a headache, make sure that you bring them in. And I want to ask you, what medication do you use for cerebral edema? I don't know if you all know that, but the answer to that is mannitol, and it is an osmotic diuretic. So let's talk about complications that we may see from cerebral trauma. Hemorrhage, which makes sense. You can see up there on the picture. Let me see if I can get it up here to draw right here. In this area right here, you can see where there's been some blood or some kind of it looks like blood to me, and you can see how it's impacting the brain and how it's pushing in on and also shifting the brain to the other side. So you think about hemorrhage, then you also think about cerebral edema, and we've already talked about that. It is an emergency if there's loss of consciousness or if the child vomits more than three times. And so if somebody gets hit in the head, you don't know whether or not to take them to the emergency room. You ask yourself, did they lose consciousness or are they vomiting? And then, of course, I would take them in, of course, if either one of those are happening. If they get hit in the head and they get right up and they're crying and crying, and you put ice on their head and they're still crying, and they then 30 minutes later are out playing the same thing that they were playing when they got hurt, I think you're okay. Then we have to also think about infection. So anytime there's an open injury to the head, you have to think, oh gosh, well, that can get in and we can cause some issues here with different bacteria that can get in through the scalp. Also, herniation, many times, not many times, but sometimes you will see a herniation through the tentorium, and that's between the cerebrum and the cerebellum. So essentially what happens is there is a downward shift of the brain tissue. And when that happens, the child is not going to have a gag reflex and there will be no pupillary reaction. So that, as you can only think about, is a huge emergency, and oftentimes there's nothing they can do with it. So let's think also about an epidural hemorrhage. That is between the dura in the skull and the children become unconscious real brief, but the thing about it is that it can change to a coma. And so an epidural hematoma can be one of those things that you really need to watch. And then a subdural hematoma or subdural hemorrhage is between the dura and the arachnoid membrane. That can happen from a birth injury, it can happen from a fall, it can happen from shaken baby syndrome. And many times, what you're going to see with these kids is they're going to be very irritable, they're going to be vomiting, and oftentimes have a seizure. So let's talk about near drowning. These kids, and you've heard of those incredible stories, I know, but the outcome is impacted, of course, on the time that the body has been submerged, and also the dive reflex. So, if the child is submerged in cold water, the blood will shunt from the periphery to the major organs, which keeps those major organs healthy. And so, you may see that they might lose a toe or a finger, but their major organs are working fine. So, the other things you need to think about are, is the child hypoxic? If the child is hypoxic for more than 4 to 6 minutes, the neurons are often irreversible and there will be significant damage. And if the child is hypoxic for a long period of time and they've come around, there's still going to be some kind of brain damage. So aspiration, is there pulmonary edema, atelectasis, airway spasms, pneumonitis, etc.? So when they were submerged in water, did they take in a big old gulp of water into their lungs? And then hypothermia, this happens very quickly in children because they have a very large body surface area compared to an adult, and also their head is extremely large. So that makes sense that they can get hypothermic very quickly. So let's talk about brain tumors. This can be a central nervous system tumor. And you can see right up there on the picture that there's a picture of a brain tumor. Most brain tumors are solid, and it's the second most common childhood cancer that we see. The classic symptom for brain tumors is a headache when they wake up in the morning and vomiting that's not related to eating. So these kids will wake up every morning and say, I have a headache. And then they go out on through the day and their headache goes away. And then they go to sleep the next night and they wake up the next morning going, I have a bad headache. And then they may just vomit periodically and you're going, what was that for? Oh, he must have a virus. And then you start putting two to two together. The child maybe start slurring their words, or they may start bumping into the wall. And there you go, we have a brain tumor. Complications of brain tumors, you're of course going to have increased intracranial pressure. Many times the pupils will be sluggish or dilated or unequal. And of course, if that is the case, you want to report that immediately and get a CT scan, MRI, etc. Now, neuroblastoma is one of those cancers. It's one of the most common malignant extracranial solid tumors that we see, and it originates in utero. You guys probably didn't know that there was a tumor that could originate in utero, but it does. And many times it's compression of the adjacent structures. So sometimes you'll see a neuroblastoma up in the brain, but you have to think about neuroblastoma. Essentially, what that is, it's created by nerve tissue. So it can be in a variety of areas. And many times we find these neuroblastomas on top of the adrenal gland. And so these kids come in with these humongous bellies, and we're going, that's kind of strange. And let me tell you that neuroblastomas are very, very difficult to treat, especially if they're like a stage four neuroblastoma. These kids don't always do so well. They'll try to go in and debulk the tumor, do chemo, many times radiation, etc. Some are successful and some are not. I think they're making more and more progress with it. Okay, the next thing we're going to talk about is bacterial meningitis. This is an acute inflammation of the meninges and the cerebral spinal fluid, usually caused by Haemophilus influenza type B. We talked about that and why we get the HIV vaccine. So since we've gotten the HIV vaccine, we're seeing less and less of the Haemophilus influenza type B meningitis, which is awesome. Now, also through OB, you've heard about group B streptococci. This is when a woman is 37, 36 to 37 weeks, we'll do a little culture in their vaginal area and down in their rectum. If it comes back positive, then we treat the mother with penicillin, or if she's allergic to penicillin, we'll treat her with some like clindamycin or some other type of antibiotic. So if the mother is not treated and the baby does get group B strep, this can cause meningitis, and these children can die very quickly within hours of getting meningitis. So it's very important that we stay on top of it. So the pathophysiology of this bacterial meningitis, the infection extends to the ventricles. There is very thick pus in the brain. There are also fibrin strands or adhesions that may occlude passages, so the CSF can't move in and out, and so therefore it's obstructed. How we diagnose this, we do a lumbar puncture, and excuse me, typically this is how we lay the child on their side with their knees curled up. So we'll curl those knees up and we'll pull their head down toward their knees and allow those vertebrae to open way, way up. And we hold on tight while the physician taps their spinal fluid. So let's talk about what we're going to see, the clinical manifestations for bacterial meningitis. The onset of a fever is going to be very, very abrupt. These kids are going to get sick very quickly. They're going to have a headache, often vomiting. They're going to be chilled. Oftentimes, people think they just have the flu. Excuse me. They will do a lumbar puncture unless it is contraindicated, and then if it is contraindicated, they will do a CT scan. The only time it would be contraindicated is if they suspect that there's an increased cranial pressure in there. We want to do rapid treatment with these guys and also often isolation. Some of these, the bacteria is airborne, and you might often have to put them either on airborne precautions or droplet precautions, depending on what type of bacteria grow out. If you have a child that comes into the emergency room, or you're admitting a child that has a quick onset of fever, chills, headache, and vomiting, please make sure that you are wearing a mask yourself, because you can end up with it. And oftentimes we go in and treat patients without thinking first, and then we end up getting very sick because of it. We're going to treat these kids with cephalosporins, excuse me, cephalosporins, And instead of, many times some physicians will want to use aminoglycosides. And if you can remember about aminoglycosides, what is the number one thing that you want to look for with aminoglycosides, or what does it cause? And it is ototoxic, so it will cause hearing impairment. So cephalosporins are clearly superior to aminoglycosides, although aminoglycosides do work well for bacterial meningitis. 10 to 15% fatality if these kids don't get treated properly and quickly. And of course, as you might think, the neonates are the most vulnerable. The other thing we want to talk about is aseptic meningitis, where there is just inflammation. There's no pulse. I mean, excuse me, no pus. Pus in their brain. And so the onset of aseptic meningitis is more gradual. And essentially, what you're going to do is just treat the symptoms. So, what kind of symptoms are we talking about? We talked about nausea and vomiting, so we might give them something for that. We might give them something for their headache. These kids also are going to be extremely irritable. Many times they'll have photophobia. You want to make sure that these guys are in a private room. The other thing with both bacterial and aseptic meningitis is that you're going to want to put them on a fluid restriction. And so you'll have to restrict their IV fluids and their PO intake. That's probably one of the hardest things to do, is put a child on fluid restriction, because they don't understand why they can't have something to drink. The other thing that we can do is make sure that we have these guys on seizure precautions. So remind yourself, what are seizure precautions? You should have the side rails padded. You should have suction available. You should have your emergency equipment ready to go in case you need to intubate them. And the other thing that we can often use is Decadron, and I want you to think about what Decadron's used for. It will decrease inflammation in the brain. One thing to think about after a child has had a lumbar puncture is to keep them flat for at least 4 hours after the lumbar puncture, so that they don't get a spinal headache. Now, tell that to a toddler who's just learned how to walk. That can be very, very difficult. So, and then you think, well, okay, well, we'll just sedate them so that they'll be flat. Well, you don't want to sedate them, because then there can be change in their neurological system status, and you don't even know it because it's been masked by the sedation. So what does a cerebral spinal fluid tell you? If it is bacterial, you're going to have increased white blood cell count. You will also have increased protein. You will have decreased glucose, and the culture will be positive. So remember that your culture won't come back until 24, 48, or 72 hours. So you may not know exactly what's growing out, but what you can know is when it comes back right away, you're going to see that there's a decreased glucose and increased protein. So you have to remember that your white blood cell count, that your white blood cells are going to eat that glucose. That's what, or the, excuse me, the bacteria eats the glucose. And so that is what's decreasing your glucose in your cerebral spinal fluid. If it is viral or aseptic, you're going to see something a little different. You're going to have elevated lymphocytes in your spinal fluid. Your protein's going to be normal. Your glucose is going to be normal because there's not bacteria eating that glucose. And the color of the fluid, it may be cloudy or it may be clear. Now remember, if you have bacterial, your fluid is going to be probably pussy looking, usually real cloudy or real pussy looking. So let's talk about how we do these awesome assessment techniques. One of them is Koenig's sign, and the other one is Brudinski's sign. The way I remember Koenig's sign is because you put the knee kind of like in a K position. When you pull the leg up like that, the child is going to feel pressure and a headache up along his spine. They're not going to like it at all, and they're really going to complain. When you do Brudinski's, you kind of make their body sort of look like a B. And so their knees come up toward their nose, and they are going to get a headache, or they're going to complain of neck pain. So also remember nuchal rigidity. All you have to do is have a child look down and put their chin to their chest. They're not going to want to do that if they have bacterial meningitis, I can promise you. They're not going to want to move their head at all. They don't even want to move their head backwards. But if you ask them to put their chin to their chest, you're going to get some resistance there. So let's talk about encephalitis. This is inflammation of the CNS. You can see the mosquito up there. Many times we get encephalitis from mosquitoes or other bugs. You can also get it with measles, mumps, varicella, rubella. Those are all things that we talked about when we were talking about vaccines. And thankfully, we have vaccines now that can kind of keep that at bay. You can also get it by enterovirus. Enterovirus is a virus that we see yearly. That is something that can be transmitted to a child. Who knows how? Coughing by other people, just laying on surfaces, etc. Also, the herpes virus can cause encephalitis, and then of course West Nile virus. Clinical manifestations are the same as you would see with any other increased intracranial pressure. You're going to see a fever, often flu-like symptoms are going to be achy feeling. Sometimes they're going to be very irritable. They're going to have nausea and vomiting, may have a headache, etc. So nursing care, you want to, if they are symptomatic, we want to make sure that we're caring for those symptoms that we can. And then also we're going to do a very thorough neurological assessment and make sure that we're doing proper hand washing. On box 28.6 in your book, you can read more about this. So let's talk about rabies. Someone mentioned this in the last lecture, so I'm glad we get to talk about it a little more. Transmission comes from saliva of an infected animal through a bite or an abrasion, and it can cause a CNS infection. And it can be fatal if it's not treated. We know that it can be fatal to animals, and it can also be fatal to human beings as well. So what we do is treat them with immunoglobulin and what we call the biploid cell vaccine. They get it on day 0, 3, 7, 14, and 28. They're IM injections, and they don't feel good. So one thing we need to do is make sure that our animals are treated for rabies. Of course, we cannot treat those raccoons that are wild that come sneak into our garage, we sure can make sure that our cats and our dogs are treated. And then prophylaxis, there are two immunizing products. They're inactivated rabies vaccines, and it just causes an immune response so that we can form antibodies. We don't usually do that in the United States, but there are other countries that will do an immunization for rabies. So let's talk about Reye syndrome. You guys may or may not have even heard of Reye syndrome. That used to be a very common thing when I was growing up. What would happen is we as children would get a fever. Our parents would give us aspirin because Tylenol was not on the market, Motrin was not on the market, and then we would get Reye syndrome. And essentially what Reye syndrome is a toxic encephalopathy. It causes cerebral edema and hepatic changes. And so you have to ask yourself, we already know about cerebral edema and what the children are going to present like, but what about these hepatic changes? What are we going to look for? This oftentimes can follow a virus like the flu or chickenpox. The way they diagnose it is through a liver biopsy. And as I already told you, it is associated with aspirin. So if you are going to do a liver biopsy, or even if you are going to do blood work, what are you going to see on their CBC? You should probably see an elevated ALT and an elevated AST. You may even see some elevated ammonia levels. And their electrolytes are going to be way out of whack. They're also going to have prolonged coags. Remember that coags are determined by how well the liver's working. So more some, excuse me, most importantly is that we have an early diagnosis and aggressive treatment. We're going to treat them for their increased cranial pressure, dehydration, and any kind of cerebral edema. These children will also have some vomiting. They're going to be very lethargic. Many times they're going to be disoriented, but they will have the appropriate response to pain. Sometimes they'll be obtundent, sometimes even a deepening coma and seizures. Sometimes they'll be delirious. They will have loss of consciousness. So, kind of going back up to the liver, so what do you want to watch for? You want to watch for bleeding, because if they have their coags are out of whack, sometimes these guys can have a bleeding disorder. You want to keep their head of bed at 30 degrees, just like you would with any other increased intracranial pressure. And you want to make sure that they have a neutral head alignment. You don't want them to be able to move their head back and forth. Sometimes what we'll do is we'll put sandbags beside their head to keep them from moving back and forth. And then we will also give these kids vitamin K, especially if they're bleeding, if bleeding begins. Because what does vitamin K do? You all should know this by now. But it helps with clotting. So seizures, we'll talk quickly about seizures. Etiology depends on the class, or excuse me, classified by the type and the etiology. In other words, where it starts and the type of seizure it is. It can be acute symptomatic with a head trauma or meningitis, or maybe even like a febrile seizure. Or it can be remote symptomatic caused by some kind of injury that we don't know about. It can be cryptogenic where there is no clear answer or clear cause, or it can be idiopathic, which can be genetic in origin. And so what a seizure is an abnormal electric discharge in the brain, and sometimes they can lose consciousness and sometimes they can't. It can be in a restricted area of the cerebral cortex or anatomic focus, or it can begin localized and spread generalized. And some things that can cause seizures, we're going to go over these a little bit more in detail, but some things that can cause seizures are lead poisoning. I already talked about febrile seizures. Jumping right back to lead poisoning, so where do you think we get lead poisoning? That can come from houses that were built before 1950. So when we have somebody that comes in for a physical, we ask them, do you live in a house that was built before 1950? Paint can chip off ledges or off a wall, or somebody can tear down or remodel, and then they go to their backyard and they burn the wood in their backyard. And so then that lead is put into the air, and it also absorbs into the ground, and then the children go play in the ground and they can get lead poisoning. The other place you can get lead poisoning is from toys from other countries who do not have regulations on lead. So we have to be very, very careful about that. Children that have had anoxic issue events will also have seizure disorders oftentimes. Trauma, which we kind of already talked about, any kind of hemorrhage in the brain, congenital defects of the brain, hypoglycemic. If you get hypoglycemic, you can have a seizure. Or even drug overdoses. So let's talk about the different types of seizures. So there are several different types of seizures. There's partial, generalized, and under each one of those are some other categories. So let's first talk about partial. Partial seizures are local, they have a local onset and they involve a small location in the brain. And there's three types of those. Simple with motor, simple with sensory, or complex or psychomotor. And so a complex partial seizure is where the consciousness is impaired or lost. Or they can have an altered behavior. They can kind of feel it coming on. They may have some hallucinations, and that can even be the psychomotor as well. A partial seizure can partial seizure can spread from one area and then progress into a more generalized or tonic-clonic seizure. And then a tonic seizure, which you will see down in the generalized seizures, is real dramatic and it can occur without warning. Let me also tell you, back up in partial seizures, when you have a simple seizure with sensory issues, you're just going to have some tingling or numbness. Like you might have tingling or numbness in a leg. And then a simple with motor, you might have a little leg twitch or something like that. And then the complex can be a leg twitch with some sensory stuff and also the hallucinations or change in the psych status of the patient. So then let's go to generalize. That includes both hemispheres without a local onset. So we're talking about both sides of the brain. The tonic seizure used to be called a clonic seizure or a grand mal seizure. And as I said before, this is the one that comes without any kind of warning. It just happens and they will have very severe shaking. It can be all over their body. Many times it's very violent jerking. And then they will often salivate. Many times they'll become apneic afterwards. And one thing that you have to be very careful about is they may stop breathing on you. And so very, very important to make sure that you have your emergency equipment ready to go. The one thing about tonic seizures is that these children will become postictal after their seizure. And postictal is kind of like a really sleepy state. They just want to take a really, really long nap after this seizure. So let's move down to the absence seizures. It used to be referred to as petit mal or lapses. And what this is, typically what happens is these children ages 4 to 12 are the ones that usually have it. They will go usually away. They'll go away by puberty. They will have a loss of consciousness for about 10 seconds. It kind of looks like they're daydreaming. And they may like drop something, like they might have a cup in their hand and suddenly drop it. And many times they'll have some twitching or even some lip smacking that goes along with it. And then the atonic or akinetic, these are drop attacks. Just like I said, this child can be just standing there with a crayon and suddenly they just lose control and it just drops. Many times they are very brief and they don't lose any kind of consciousness. Although when you try to talk to them, they really don't talk to you back. And then we're talking too about myoclonic seizures, which is a twitching. These are very, very brief and they may or may not lose consciousness, just like the atonic or akinetic or the drop attacks. They may or may not lose consciousness. And they may lose, with a myoclonic, they may lose their muscular tone and maybe just like fall. And so you have to be really careful. The other thing that we have to remember too is they may void on themselves and that can be very embarrassing for a child. And then the last one are infantile seizures. We don't know really what causes them. It usually goes away after the first year of life. Once again, I remind you about seizure precautions, and what kind of meds would we be treating these children with. So anti-epileptic meds, you've heard of them, some of them before. We want to make sure that we include things like Valium, Dilantin, Tegretol. Some of those are anti-epileptic meds, but some of them are used for other things as well. We want to make sure that we get a lead level on all these kids. We want to make sure that we get a white blood cell count on these kids. We want to make sure that we get electrolytes on them, including glucose, and also a toxicology. We're also going to get an EEG on these children. Make sure that these kids don't drink caffeine before their EEG. This next slide just kind of shows you exactly what I just talked about. So, epilepsy are two or more unprovoked seizures. And so, it's a symptom of underlying disease process. So, once you've had two or more unprovoked seizures, you can say that this child has epilepsy. I used to always get really tickled with people that say they have epilepsy, and I'm like, oh, okay, you just have a seizure disorder. And so, you do have to have more than one, so two or more unprovoked seizures. And they may cease once the condition is addressed. So their seizures may go away once they end up getting proper medication, or say we deal with their lead level. If a child comes in with a high lead level, what we'll do is put them in the hospital and chelate them, and so essentially what it does is it binds to the lead and pulls it out of their body. To classify, you're going to assign to appropriate epilepsy syndrome. Optimal treatment requires diagnosis and determinant cause. We've got to find out what's causing this and then treat them appropriately. And as you guys probably know, for those adolescents that turn 16 and they do have epilepsy, they cannot drive until they're seizure-free for 1 year. Some other things that can help treat seizures are, we already mentioned the medications, but then you can also think about a ketogenic diet. And one thing I do want to remind you is that ketogenic diets and other diets are going to be on your NCLEX. So please don't just poo-poo diets. You want to make sure that you know all your different kinds of diets. The ketogenic diet is a high-in-fat diet, a low-in-carb diet, and you also get adequate protein. And then you can have a vagus nerve stimulator, which is an implantable device that goes inside the brain, and when a child has a seizure, it will alarm and it will keep the child from having a seizure. I put surgical on here. They can oftentimes go in and surgically remove any kind of lesion that's causing a seizure. And so then you ask yourself, what is my role in this? And probably the best thing that you could possibly do is make sure that they get their medications and also that you are educating these families. So what happens when a child goes into status epilepticus? And this is a series of intervals where a child is having seizure after seizure after seizure. They do not regain consciousness, or if the seizure is lasting for more than 30 minutes. It does require intervention. We quickly put an IV in this child and or an intraosseous, which is essentially kind of looks like a plug that is screwed literally into their femur, where we go straight into the bone marrow and we can give medications through that. Status epilepticus can, of course, lead to exhaustion, as you can only imagine, and respiratory failure, and sometimes even death when these children cannot, their brain cannot stop. So, as I mentioned before, you want to get your emergency kit ready or your code cart close by. You want to make sure that you have an airway. You want to make sure that you have oxygen available and suction. You want to make sure that you have IV medications and that you can keep these children thermoregulated. At home, many times children with cerebral palsy have seizure after seizure after seizure, or oftentimes status epilepticus. And what they will do is give rectal diazepam. It comes in a liquid form, and they just put a rectal tube in there and they can squirt it up in their rectum. Many times they'll come in suppositories and then sometimes even intranasal Versed, which will help. You don't ever want to put something in someone's mouth that is having a seizure, which makes sense because they'll choke. So let's talk quickly about hydrocephalus. Hydrocephalus is an inability for the cerebrospinal fluid to reabsorb. Or to absorb, rather. And so, what happens is the ventricles in the brain get really, really large, and there can be a number of reasons why this does happen. It can be congenital or acquired. Usually, children younger than 10 to 12 years old, you will see their suture lines open. Their suture lines cannot close, and typically by age 12, their suture lines are completely closed up and solidified, so you can't open them back up. So it's very, very important that these children with hydrocephalus, that we're allowing these suture lines to close properly. So clinical manifestations. This is why we do head circumference on all children younger than 2 years old. If we see a big jump in head circumference, we're going to say, oh my goodness, either A, somebody measured them wrong the first time, or B, they have hydrocephalus. We will look for bulging fontanelles. Many times these children will be real sleepy. They will have a cri du chat cry, which is essentially sounds like a cat. They will have those sun-setting eyes or pupils, will be real sluggish, and they will also have signs and symptoms of increased intracranial pressure. On my first audio that I was going to do for you all, I talked about a child that I took care of when I was in hospice, who was born with hydrocephalus. The mother was told that the child would never live. And the child did. He lived and is, I don't know if he's still living or not. I took care of him for about probably 15 years ago. But at the time, when I went to visit him, I was a hospice nurse. And the child literally, he had a head that was probably the size of a saucer that you would go sledding on. And it was only about 4 inches tall. And the reason why is because they would move him in this nursing home from side to side every 2 hours to keep his head from breaking down. And it took about 6 people to move him from side to side because his head was so incredibly large. And if that head snapped at any moment, it would break his spinal column. It was just really interesting because he was growing as a young adolescent, just like any other adolescent with his body. But he had an extreme case of hydrocephalus. The sad thing about it is, and you will see on this next page, is that hydrocephalus is very treatable. And so what they will do is go in and do an endoscopic fenestration. In other words, they will cut open an area to allow the spinal fluid to come through if there's an occlusion. The other thing they can do is put in a shunt, a PA shunt or a VA shunt, which is a ventricular arterial shunt, or a VP shunt, which is a ventroperitoneal shunt. And I would say that the VP shunt is probably the most common shunt. And essentially what they do is they lead a shunt from the ventricle down into the peritoneal cavity, and there is where the fluid will drain, which allows for normal brain growth. Now the thing about the VP shunts is that these children later on in life will often have to have them revised because they grow. And then the other thing that can happen is that the VP shunt can get infected. So there is an hour and 3 minutes of discussion on the neurological system. I hope this is helpful. If you have any questions at all, please email me and I will try to answer them for you. Thanks.